I'm happy to be here to celebrate Thibaut. I was lucky to collaborate with Thibaut already 15 years ago. And in fact, I'd like to spend 2 minutes to talk about this old paper. Not to make it dramatic, but I will need it in my talk. So idea was very simple. Let's take any static black hole metric and replace TT component. We'll just make a small deformation, add small parameter to GTT. And then the black hole geometry immediately changes. And instead of black hole, we have a wormhole. And there are some interesting features. Well, as I said, there is no horizon. Horizon is replaced by a wormhole throat. And there appears a new time scale. New time scale, which depends on epsilon. That's basically time needed for light sent from outside to go to the center of the throat and come back. And assuming that epsilon is exponentially small, this new time scale can be quite large, of order of evaporation time. And looking at this object for time much smaller than this new scale, we would not see any difference. And that would be any difference from the true black hole. And that would be a perfect mimicker for a black hole. We consider static case, non-rotating, and rotating case was considered by these people. So in this talk, so here in that old paper, this metric was just some abstract metric, and it did not satisfy any gravitational equations. But today in my talk, I will try to demonstrate that wormholes of this type appear quite naturally in the semiclassical gravity for a large class of quantum states. So speaking about classical black holes, which are well, subject also of this workshop, they are typical solutions which appear in local theory of gravity. Speaking about quantum theory, the first step would be quantize metafields on the background of this classical black hole. And then what appears immediately, that there is certain freedom when we do that. Freedom, which is usually phrased as we can choose different quantum states. Well, speaking about renormalized test-energy tensor, there is also freedom to add some certain piece to T menu, which is traceless and covariantly conserved. And that freedom, well, bring us possibility to define different quantum states. The quantum states known in the literature are the following. So Hartle-Hawking state. In this case, stress energy tensor is regular at black hole horizon, and at infinity it describes thermal Hawking radiation. Another state is Boulware state. It is singular at horizon, but it is vanishing at infinity. So there is no radiation at infinity. And more realistic state is Unruh state, which describes quantum state for collapsing star. So black hole is formed as a result of gravitational collapse. That would be most appropriate quantum state to describe such a process. Unruh state is most realistic, but it is non-static, non-stationary, and I will not discuss it in my talk. and we'll focus on Hartle-Hawking and Boulware state. So let two pieces of picture, right? So classical black hole, quantum field on the black hole. But we would like to have some unified picture. We want to put these two ingredients in one, let's call it quantum gravitational theorem. And that would allow us to talk about quantum black holes. And what kind of questions you would like to address? Here's a list of my questions. So first of all, I would like to know if what happens to black hole horizon when I take, in this quantum gravitational theorem. And are there still solutions with horizons? And what are the new features which are possible, possibly appear due to non-locality of this quantum gravitational theory? And the second class of questions, what are the, how answer to this question, first question is related or depends on the choice of quantum state? And most importantly, what are the back reactor geometries of the quantum states which I discussed? I should mention previous work, this kind of questions we discussed for many years in the literature. So my theory would be, my quantum theory would be semi-classical gravity. So in this picture, metric is not quantized, but matter fields are propagating on this classical metric. Are quantized, and if I integrate over such quantum fields, I end up with some contribution to gravitational action, which I call quantum action. And in general, that would be my new gravitational theory. So it's classical theory plus new terms due to quantum fields. It is functional metric, and new quantum term is generally very complicated. It is non-local. There is an approach by Barvinsky, Volkovysky, Gusev, and Zhitnikov, developed for almost 10 years, how to compute this quantum action. Lisa suggested expanded in powers of curvature. And this is very promising approach, but it's rather complicated and is difficult to use. For instance, the cubic terms in the terms which are cubic in curvature, they have 29 invariants, and in quadratic they have 6 invariants. So it's too many, and it's quite complicated to use this approach in any real problem. But it's we can see here that gamma of Laplace, some function of Laplace operator, and here. For cubic terms, they are non-local objects. They are non, so gamma, this little gamma is logarithmic in Laplacian, and this big gamma becomes like one of a box. So they are very, very non-local objects. In two dimensions, things are simplified. If I had a choice, I would probably live in two dimensions. There is only left and right. It's easy to make choices. in two dimensions, if I speak about quantum two-dimensional conformal field theory, then this integrated, after integrating out the quantum fields, the action can be easily computed. This is so-called Polyakov action, famous Polyakov action. And we see that it is non-local. So it has one of a box. So in reality, one of a box should be replaced by Green's function. So what we see here is two rich scalars and Green's function in between. But it's quite simple, and that makes two-dimensional models very attractive as toy models to address quantum, the quantum black holes and information problem. And since 1992, this subject was very, very popular and discussed in the literature. So in my talk, I will first discuss two-dimensional dilaton gravity model and address these questions in two dimensions. This part is based on ongoing research with Yuan and Depp. Depp is a professor in India, and Yuan is a student, PhD student in Tour. And second part is four-dimensional story. It's based on early work with Kliman and Depp. Kliman used to be our student in Tour. Now he's a postdoc in Canada. So I understand that time in this nice lecture hall is faster than outside. So my program minimum to speak about two-dimensional gravity. And if I have time, I will discuss four-dimensional story. So in two dimensions, as we all know, Richard Schuyler doesn't define any gravitational equations, and we have to introduce some extra field to define gravitational dynamics. And usually that would be one of possible ways is introduce Schuyler field, so-called dilaton. And this action, which is present here, is the most popular action, dilaton action, so-called Strin-Spiet action. And the solution to this, well, we vary with respect to metric, we vary with respect to dilaton. We get some equations. These equations can be exactly integrated. A nice thing about these equations, the trace free gravitational equation takes this form. And that means that I can define, so it implies existence of Killing vector. So epsilon mu contracted with gradient of phi is automatically Killing vector on these equations. That means my the general solution to these equations is static and can be brought to Schwarzschild-like form. And it describes generically, well, it describes a two-dimensional black hole with a temperature proportional to lambda, so it doesn't depend on the mass. That's a peculiarity of two dimensions. It has also certain entropy proportional to exponent of minus 2 phi, and phi is the value of dilaton at the horizon. Speaking about quantum field, so as I said, I will integrate over quantum fields and end up with Polyakov action. I prefer to write this action in local form. This is local form. So if I vary with respect to psi, that will give me this equation. And technically, psi is one of box A. So and I come back to usual non-local form. On dilaton, dilaton gravity, Richard Schuyler is minus 2 box phi. And it means that there is a relation between psi and phi. That basically this relation. Psi is minus 2 phi plus W. And W is the solution to homogeneous Laplace equation. There is also always a freedom to choose this W. For static metric, this equation can be easily solved, and it's basically this, it takes this form, so it's C over G. And C is a constant. And you will see in a moment that this W or constant C contains information about the quantum state. So computing stress energy tensor, which is just variation of Polyakov action with respect to metric. This is stress energy tensor of quantum field. We find for energy density this expression, and we see that it contains generally it contains a divergent term. So it is divergent where at the horizon, where g of x is zero. At infinity, it's positive, proportional to c plus 2 lambda squared. So now I can define my Hartle-Hawking state. Hartle-Hawking state, by definition, the state which is regular at the horizon. So this guy should vanish. And let's say our first surprise, we have two solutions for c. C equals 0, c minus 4 lambda. At infinity, it, as it should, describes a thermal Hawking radiation. At horizons, a little small negative value. Now, Boulware state, by definition, is the state which doesn't contain any radiation at infinity. And there is only one state value, c minus 2 lambda. So it's at infinity, it is zero, but of course it is it is singular at the horizon. But in general, we have a family of states parameterized by c. There is interesting symmetry. So if I take difference of density, energy density for two values of c, it is zero if not only when c1 equals c2, but also when c2 and c1 are related by this relation. That explains why I have two values of c for Hartle-Hawking. And so this kind of symmetry exists in only space of quantum states. And Boulware state is symmetric under such a map. Now I want to bring all pieces together and consider consistent picture. So my two-dimensional gravitational theory consists of classical Dilton gravity plus Polyakov action plus a new term which was added by Russo, Saskind, and Tarlatsos. This is local quantum, local term. And nice thing about this section that equations are still exactly integrable. So a combination of dilaton and trace of t-mu. T-mu now has these three pieces. Leads to this simple equation. And here there are two possibilities. Either phi is constant, then from other equations follows that I Richard scalar should be constant, minus 2 lambda squared. And this is the Sitter spacetime. I will not, it might be interesting by itself to discuss this solution, but I will not do it here. The other interesting solution when r equals minus 2 box phi, and that is precisely what we had in classical case. So again, if I introduce psi, there is a relation between psi and phi, and there is a freedom to choose w, and w is solution to Laplace equation. Then quantum corrected black hole or Hartle-Hawking state corresponds, as I already discussed, to omega to the case when w is zero, so psi is just minus 2 phi. Still, equations, trace-free gravitational equations obtained by varying this complete action with respect to g-mu takes this nice form, and this form tells me immediately that there is still a killing vector. So the general solution is static, and that is precisely the form for this metric. I should say that, of course, black hole solution in IST model was obtained by IST people. I here just rewrite this solution in a nice Schwarzschild-like form, which is more appropriate for my for what I'm doing. If you look at this solution, we find immediately that first of all, Minkowski space is not a solution, and let us clear why. Because at infinity of Hartle-Hawking state, I have a thermal gas. So thermal gas curves the space-time, and it's not anymore Minkowski. What it is clear from this metric. So if I put A to zero, let still g of phi is given by some function. So this term is actually produced by, it's a back reaction of a thermal radiation. This metric still describes a black hole, generally black hole. If A larger than A critical, it still is a black hole with the horizon. And temperature of such a black hole is still lambda over 2 pi, as in classical case. General C. A general C state. So I remind you that in this case, psi is related to minus 2 phi plus w, and w has C minus over g. And equation still can be integrated, and this is a general solution. This is our new result. And it might be difficult to digest this form in a few seconds, but let's discuss it. So metric here, metric function g, it is related proportional to z, function of phi. And a relation between z and phi is given by this equation. So GHH of phi is what I had in the Hartle-Hawking state. So G phi phi, IHH has a horizon, but G of my G for general constant C or constant A, A and C are related like that. I have a horizon in this metric, so G vanishes if Z vanishes. But Z never vanishes at any finite phi. And it means that for any value of A different from zero, this metric doesn't have a horizon. A more careful analysis shows that if A is A of C is negative, this metric describes a wormhole. And if A C of C is positive, then this metric describes a naked singularity. So let's look a bit more carefully at the back reactor geometry for Boulware state. That's basically same equations which I had before. So A here is, I take exact value for A. So G value, there is a minimal value for this function. And this minimal value is a kappa over, I can express it in terms of classical entropy. It's basically related to value of dilaton at classical horizon. And this function, metric function, never vanishes. And the whole space-time is actually two copies of the same asymptotically flat space-time glued together at some point, which I call phi minimum, which is the throat of the wormhole. So this is a completely regular space-time. It doesn't have any singularity. And interestingly, now flat space, Minkowski space, or more precisely, linear dilaton vacuum, is a solution to field equations. It belongs to this class of metrics for certain value of A.
Do I have more time? 7 minutes.
7 minutes is okay. Sorry. So in four dimensions, story, as I said, is more complicated, much more complicated, and one has to use, we cannot use that expansion in curvature, and because it's difficult, and we need to use some smart tricks. I will describe what tricks we can use. So let me first say, remind you about certain universality at the horizon. So let's take any spherically symmetric metric. Suppose that there is a horizon, it means that there is a zero for function g. Finite temperature means that there is a simple zero. And if I factorize g, so now what remains is so-called optical metric when gtt is one or minus one, it depends on the signature. Then near horizon this g of z becomes exponentially, it's a universal behavior, beta contains information about temperature. And what remains here is optical metric, and optical metric is a product of one-dimensional space, which corresponds to time, and three, well, usually it's three. Well, here it's written for any d, so if d is two, it's three-dimensional. Space, which I call here M3. And there is again universality if I approach horizon, so z goes to infinity, this space becomes, approaches hyperbolic space of radius beta over 2 pi. And I remind that beta is related to Hawking temperature. There is another interesting property of horizon, it is a minimal surface. In fact, we can inversely logic assume that there is a surface in space-time, in static space-time, which is minimal, and it will immediately follow from Einstein equations that it is a, this surface is a horizon. We will use that. And that's class of metric metrics which I will consider. This is a general static metric with three functions, omega, n and r. So if there is a horizon, omega is, I didn't write it here. So omega is the exponent of sigma, sigma behaves like that, and the optical metric approaches this universal form. So our idea is to use space. We cannot, unfortunately, in four dimensions, we cannot integrate like a conformal anomaly. But what is known is the relation between quantum action computed for conformally rescaled metric. Well, there are two metrics, metric G and rescaled metric. Sigma is conformal factor, and the difference is given by a local function. A and B are some constants, which are called conformal charges. So we use this action, we use this transformation, assuming that exponential of 2 sigma is my omega. So I have factorized GTT. What is left is optical metric, but we still need this term here, computed on optical metric. And here is my ansatz for this optical metric. It's basically, in general, it again can be expanded in some power in series with respect to curvature or this three-dimensional space. And we drop the high curvature terms. General structure can be found in the paper of Gusev and Zelnikov. And this result is actually exact if N3 is a three-dimensional hyperboloid. So now my gravitational action has three functions, sigma, omega, n, and r. And variation with respect to n well, gives me certain terms, which is divergent. It is divergent, and that means that what we actually consider is the Boulware vacuum. Accidentally, for certain choice of n0 and 1, so scalars, fermions, and vector fields, this leading singularity disappears. And curiously, it disappears exactly for n equal 4 super young mils. But that might be just an accident, and we have to look at subleading terms. So generally, we don't have a solution to these equations with the horizon, which is natural, because we have this corresponds to Boulware state. Well, instead of looking at horizon, we can look at minimal sphere. Let bring us some restrictions on conditions on r of rho and omega. Well, that part is very technical. Let me just bring you to the final formula. Let's restriction which comes from equations on the minimal value of omega. I remind you that omega is GTT component of the metric. And from this equation, we see that it cannot be zero because the right-hand side is positive and omega zero is exponential. So omega is between zero and omega zero. And this omega zero is actually exponential of minus Hawking black hole entropy if you compute it in classical case. So and if A goes to zero, this parameter A, omega zero becomes zero, and the throat becomes a horizon. So it's limiting procedure to get a classical black hole. So here's my conclusion. Back reactor geometry of Boulware state in semi-classical gravity is a wormhole. We demonstrated this in two-dimensional case and in four-dimensional case. Minimal non-zero value of GTT, TT component of the metric, is bounded by classical black hole entropy. So it becomes one over entropy in two-dimensional case and exponential of entropy in four dimensions. And the two-dimensional examples show that there is an infinite, actually, family of possible quantum states, and which are represented by horizon-free back reactor geometries. And it looks like Hartle-Hawking state is the only state in the whose back reactor geometry has a horizon. We see it explicitly in two dimensions, and it's very likely to be the same in four dimensions. But all these deviations of the wormhole geometries are very small and very hard to measure in real life. So here is my question. I first wrote like five questions, but then I erased all of them, left this one. So if you look around us and we find that there are many black holes detected directly or indirectly. So I'll be sure that all these black holes are really black holes and not wormholes. And let me leave you with this question. Thank you very much and happy birthday.